Next on Unsolved Mysteries. A young man is found shot to death in his bedroom. Investigators say it was a suicide, but his parents say it was murder. Three extraordinary house pets become three extraordinary heroes. A star witness is set to testify against the Hell's Angels. But then? And a mother is on death row for killing her two young children. Her family claims that there's new evidence that proves she's innocent.
Our team is standing by. Maybe you can help solve one of our cases. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Join us.
Arlington, Virginia.
I thought I left the lights on.
Beth George and her husband Tom Burkett returned to their home near the campus of Marymount University. Their son Tommy is a student there, but he is staying with them for the holidays.
Tommy!
When his parents walk into his bedroom, they discover a horrible scene.
No!
Tommy is upright on his sofa, lifeless. Tommy Burkett had been shot once through the mouth. A revolver rested in his hands. The police said that it was suicide, but Tommy's parents have always believed that he was murdered. Their suspicions began the moment they discovered their son's body.
I went over close to him, and I knelt down beside him, and I touched his hands. They were stone cold.
Tom. Gun. Something's not right.
Tom Burkett was surprised to find the gun cylinder unlatched. It could not have been fired in that position. Paramedics arrived on the scene, followed quickly by police. The lead detective soon emerged from Tommy's room with an old bank deposit slip.
I have something to show you.
On one side was a note which said simply, I want to be cremated.
This is Tommy's handwriting.
Fire and rescue squad said Tommy's been dead for hours.
No, that's not true. It just happened. Probably happened.
I was dumbfounded at that comment because it didn't take a medical person to recognize that Tommy had been dead for several hours. He was cold, he was stiff, blooded, dried. Any layman would have said several hours.
The gun was processed. An autopsy was conducted, photographs were taken, a thorough and acceptable crime scene was conducted.
To the police, the facts spoke for themselves. Tommy's death was an open and shut case of suicide. But Beth and Tom were certain their son had been murdered. It wasn't just the unlatched gun and the suspicious note. Tommy's glasses, wallet, and driver's license were missing.
Come in.
Oh, Mr. Burkett. Oh, you have my condolences.
When his parents went to Tommy's dorm room to collect his belongings, the driver's license mysteriously appeared.
How did you get this?
I'm sorry.
According to Tom and Beth, school administrators would not provide any information about the student who had turned in Tommy's driver's license. Tommy's parents decided to talk to their neighbors to see if they had noticed anything unusual on the day Tommy died.
Several neighbors reported seeing Tommy's car being chased by a larger, darker car. One neighbor saw the cars coming and he thought, this is serious, it's life or death. Another neighbor reported that one of the cars involved in the chase at one point drove through someone's lawn. Tommy's car was apparently run off the road and he was assaulted. He got away from his attackers and made it back to our house.
Tommy's body was exhumed for a second autopsy. It revealed abrasions and bruising around his right ear and a broken jaw.
Tom, come here.
A few weeks after Tommy's death, Beth noticed a spray of small reddish marks on the stairway.
It looks like scattered faint blood stains.
They hired Paul Kish, a blood stain expert based in New York. He confirmed the spots were blood.
There we go.
It's not consistent with being created from an individual committing suicide in a room sitting on a sofa. Some other violent altercation took place where blood was shed with a lot of energy being exerted towards the blood, like a gunshot.
This spent bullet was found in the wall of Tommy's room. But curiously, forensic analysis found that there was no blood or tissue on it.
I'm calling about some information concerning my son, Tom.
Beth made the decision to find out if Tommy had called 911 on the day he died.
Do you have any records of him making any 911 calls that day?
She said, well, on the computer screen, it shows his name and the time that he called and that he made two consecutive calls, but the message has been deleted.
Do you have any records of any complaints he may have made against any persons?
She said, yes, he had filed a complaint at the end of October and at the end of August.
What was the nature of the complaints?
She said, I'll have to check with my supervisor. So she was gone several minutes and came back and said, I don't know why his name is on the computer, but he didn't call 911.
It's my understanding that the information that the Burkettes came up with about the 911 call was well after the 30 days, and the tape that would have been on the machine that particular night had already been routinely erased.
Beth and Tom remembered a strange series of events that took place a few weeks before their son's death.
Hello?
Mom, they smashed my mailbox and took my paycheck. They took everything.
It began with a phone call from Tommy.
Tommy was normally very poised, very calm, and he was just frantic.
What do you think was in there?
Well, something I didn't want anyone to know about. I think they found out what I'm doing.
Since he was not positive they had found something out, he was not going to divulge exactly what he was worried about.
What's wrong with you?
Beth claimed that several sources told her that Tommy was assaulted a few days later by a student, and then he went to confront his attacker.
Later told by a student at the university that the young man who had Tommy's driver's license after he was dead was the same student who had beaten Tommy up.
Tom and Beth gathered more information, some from curious sources. They concluded that Tommy was working as a DEA informant and that a group of students dealing drugs on campus conspired to kill him.
A number of sources, mostly anonymous, have come to us and helped us piece together a story. And in most instances, their accounts corroborate each other. And what we've learned about our son was that he was a paid DEA informant, that there were a group of students on the campus who were dealing drugs. They felt Tommy knew too much and that they conspired with others to kill him.
Beth and Tom are convinced that their neighbors saw Tommy being chased by the killers and that he got home in time to call 911 before they burst in. An informant told Beth and Tom that their son was beaten to death with a baseball bat and that phone books were used to minimize bruising and absorb blood spat.
The story fit in with everything we had noticed and could not account for during the previous months. For example, we had noticed our phone books were missing the week after Tommy died. Also, there had been a ball bat in Tommy's bedroom, and the gripping tape had been stripped off the bat.
Tom and Beth
have names of the students they suspect were involved in Tommy's death. There's not enough evidence to say their names publicly at this point, but I believe with some of the evidence they've collected over the past 2 years that they may have the right people.
There's this sense of rage that nobody's doing anything. No matter how much information is dumped in the laps of law enforcement people, they don't do anything.
It is a suicide until substantial, credible information is brought to us. At that point, we will examine all the information, just as we have for the past years.
The U.S. Drug Enforcement Agency has denied any connection with Tommy Burkett, and the local police still consider his death a suicide. If you have any information about the death of Tommy Burkett, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, dramatic rescues by extraordinary four-legged heroes.
You're about to meet Boo, Oscar, and Ringo. Each is a household pet, and each is responsible for saving a life. Just how they did it and why they did it is an unsolved mystery.
The Yuba River in California. Lillian McDermott was romping with her Newfoundland, Boo. Boo is a big dog, but still only a puppy.
It was the summer and the Yuba was very inviting. And so I thought it was a great opportunity for a Newfoundland to play in the water, chasing sticks and having fun.
Upstream, an amateur prospector named Link Hill had just finished dredging the river for gold. When Link came into view, Boo suddenly lost interest in chasing sticks.
I leaned down to see what it was he was looking at, and I saw what I thought was a log rolling in the white water. I looked again, and here, an arm came up out of the white water, holding a small gas can.
Lillian was at a loss, but the puppy knew exactly what had to be done.
Go, Boo!
Boo swam straight into a strong current to reach the drowning stranger. He grabbed Link's arm and hauled him back to shore. It turned out that Link Hill was a deaf mute, unable to speak or to hear. And if not for Boo, he most likely would have drowned. Some experts believe that Boo's response may have been triggered by psychic abilities.
What that animal felt was that man's fear. And he realized that was not a log, you know, because he could feel the emotion coming from that man and the emotion of that man calling out in his mind for help. That's all that dog needed.
He's a Newfoundland, bred for a number of tasks, one of which is to perform water rescues. It's something that's innate, or some people use the term instinctive, that animals do because of their genetic heritage.
Oscar, a Chesapeake Bay retriever, has been a constant companion and best friend to his owner, Chris Eschenberg.
He learned early on that people were good, and he just loves to be around people. And in fact, that's one of the things that's most surprising about what actually happened.
On a hot July evening, Chris returned home, and the house was quiet. This was odd because Oscar usually gave him a noisy welcome.
Take it easy, take it easy. What do you want? Go, just take it, okay. Please.
At that point, I then started to think about Oscar. I was worried that I was going to open the door. Oscar was going to try to greet this guy like he greets all of my friends that walk into the house. And this guy was just going to react by shooting him.
But Oscar was nowhere to be seen. He had plans of his own.
finally, this guy was able to get his arm free, and in that action of freeing the arm, he hit me. I was a little disoriented for a moment, and by the time I regained my composure, he was gone. I could hear him getting out of the gate.
Oscar was drenched in blood, but it wasn't his blood. It was the robber's.
You're fine, pal.
This is merely reaffirmed in me that I have a very dynamic, live, interesting, intelligent creature that I'm sharing my life with, and who in this respect probably saved my life.
First off, it's almost sure that Oscar was aware of the intruder before Chris got home. He heard him, he smelled him, and whether it was territorial behavior or protective behavior or a combination of both, it's impossible to say. But he definitely took the initiative, took the offense, because of all these cues that were telling him, this is not normal, something isn't right.
However, dogs aren't the only animals capable of protecting their owners. Ray and Carol Stanner owe their lives to a three-year-old cat named Ringo. It was a summer day, and the Stanners were both at home. Ray was recovering from surgery, and Carol had a foot ailment. Both had been suffering from memory loss, high blood pressure, and chronic fatigue.
What I was noticing the most was terrible headaches, dizziness. I was sleeping all the time.
Carol noticed that Ringo was acting strangely. She thought that he wanted to go out.
Okay, go on, Ringo.
I opened the door, he won't go out. So I said, okay, kitty, and closed the door.
No sooner did Carol get settled down than Ringo wanted to go out again. So Carol opened the door again.
Go on out. Go, Ringo.
He turns up at me and gives a really high meow. And it was obvious I was to come out, so I walked out with him.
Ringo led Carol around the side of the house.
All of a sudden, he started digging in our landscaping.
What is it, kitty?
And then he opened up his mouth and curled his lips up as if something had a terrible smell.
Oh my God.
That smell was lethal methane gas. Carol immediately called the gas company, and within minutes, a service technician arrived.
Let me take a reading here.
He put a tool in the ground and a siren went off.
Well, this is way above normal. This is very, very unusual.
He told us we're at explosive levels. I've got to turn your gas off right now or you're going to blow.
The Steiners had a large split in the gas pipe at the very spot where Ringo had been digging. Deadly amounts of gas had been seeping into the house.
We looked at each other, then we looked at the cat, and I said, my gosh, Ray, Ringo saved our lives.
Was it instinct, or are some animals guided by unexplained psychic abilities? We may never know, but to their owners, it hardly matters. They are alive to tell the tale. Next, a fugitive who murdered a policeman escapes from prison, but thanks to you, is recaptured. And later, an outlaw biker gang takes revenge on a witness. Catoosa, Oklahoma. A small town police chief, J.B. Hamby, responds to an emergency call from a local business.
Freddy, get out of here!
Twenty shots are fired in a matter of seconds. One robber is killed and the other is hit twice, but escapes. Less than 5 minutes later, Chief Hamby dies from gunshot wounds. He was a 24-year veteran of law enforcement. The surviving gunman, David Gordon Smith, was later captured and was sentenced to life in prison for the murder.
Open 43!
Because of good behavior, Smith became a prison trustee. Then 7 years after the murder, Smith escaped. Update. Spearfish, South Dakota.
Following the airing of the David Gordon Smith case on Unsolved Mysteries, an anonymous tip was received giving us his location. He was working as a service manager at an automobile dealership. Authorities in South Dakota went to his place of employment. He was arrested without incident, and he readily admitted his identity upon questioning.
There's a tremendous amount of relief. It was equivalent to a long-term, gigantic debt being paid off.
David Gordon Smith was returned to Oklahoma and is now serving his sentence at the state penitentiary. He received an additional 4 years for the escape. Champlain, New York. Lee Carter Jr. was the kind of guy who always tried to do the right thing. But then one morning, doing the right thing got him killed. A bomb was placed under the seat of his Porsche that ended his life.
There's been no closure of any kind. I wake up in the morning, he's the first thing I think about. I go to bed at night, I'd say most of the time it's the first thing I'm thinking about, the last thing I'm thinking about.
The bomb was planted by this man, Richard Valley, in a battle for control of drugs and prostitution. Police say that Valley's job was to kill people who double-crossed the Hell's Angels biker gang. Lee Carter Jr. lived near the Canadian border. He was approached by associates of Valley who wanted to use his home as a safe house. The gang planned to smuggle a major shipment of cocaine from the United States into Canada.
54 keys at the price we discussed. That's right.
Carter went to the police and agreed to act as an informant. The drug deal was quickly shut down, and Valley was charged with conspiracy to import cocaine.
My son didn't get into detail on it to me at all. He did tell me he was working with the state police. He told me he was helping them. And I started to ask him what it was about, and he said it was best that I didn't get involved in it.
But before the case could go to trial, Lee Carter Jr., the main witness, was eliminated. Richard Valley was known to be a demolitions expert. Police believed Richard Valley planted the bomb that killed Lee Carter Jr.
Rick Valley obviously made the decision that if he took out the witness, had the witness killed, then there was nobody to testify him against court, the drug charge would have to be dismissed, which, in effect, is what happened.
With the star witness dead, the drug charges against Valley were dropped. It took 2 years for New York and Canadian authorities to gather enough evidence to charge Valley with Lee's murder. He was finally arrested in Canada, and while in custody, another inmate broke his jaw in a jailhouse fight. Over the next few weeks, he was treated at a local hospital, and two guards were always with him.
During the course of his visit, he had consistently set up where he would take a shower around 8 o'clock. He had been on the phone and indicated to one of the guards that he would like the guard to wait there because he was waiting for an important phone call from his attorney. He then went to take a shower with the other guard. As the both of them entered the shower room, the one guard was accosted.
What took you? With the help of an accomplice, Valley escaped.
When I think of Richard Valley, I think of an individual that thinks nothing of taking life, thinks nothing of anyone else whatsoever. He is it, and that's all. He has no values. It would help considerably to know that at least the individual wasn't out there living high on the hog while he has taken someone else's life.
Update. While in Montreal, Canada, Richard Valley was pulled over for drunk driving. He was released on bail. Later, when the police checked his fingerprints, they realized that he was a wanted fugitive and quickly tracked him down. Richard Valley was tried and convicted in Albany, New York, for the murder of Lee Carter Jr. Coming up, a mother is convicted of murdering her two young boys. Her family says that she's a victim, not a killer. Rowlett, Texas.
Aaron!
Darlene Lynn Routier, a housewife and mother of three, makes a frantic call to 911. Within 5 minutes, the first police officer arrived. Darlene's eldest son, Devin, is dead from 4 knife wounds. His brother, Damon, has been savagely attacked and takes his last breath in the care of a paramedic. Darlie has a deep gash in her neck and wounds on her arms, but she survives. In a dramatic turn of events, Darlie Lynn Routier would be charged with the murder of her own children.
We, the jury, find the defendant, Darlie Lynn Routier, guilty of the offense of capital murder.
8 months later, Darlie Lynn Routier is convicted of killing her two little boys. She is sentenced to die by lethal injection.
I never thought that Darlie did this. Devin and Damon's killer is running free, and that's what this is about, the truth and finding justice for Devin and Damon. That's the most important thing is, we've got to save her life before they execute this innocent girl.
I've been wrongfully convicted. I'm innocent. I've been done wrong. There has been a lot of terrible wrong things that have been done to me and my family.
Darlie Lynn Routier has always proclaimed her innocence. Her family believes that crucial evidence was overlooked during her trial. A juror who voted to convict her is now convinced that he made a mistake. But authorities argue that their case against Darlie Lynn is airtight.
Say hi, Damon.
Hi.
The Routiers were living the American dream. 3 beautiful children, a happy marriage, and a majestic house in a wealthy suburb of Dallas. But in one night, the Routiers would lose it all.
Wow, way to go, Devin.
Darlie claims that she too was viciously attacked when Devin and Damon were murdered.
Mrs. Routier, can you tell me anything at all about what happened?
Rowlett police detectives interviewed Darlie shortly after surgery. She was still sedated.
I was asleep on the couch.
Darlie told investigators that on the night of the attack, she, Devin, and Damon had fallen asleep in the downstairs family room while watching TV. Her husband, Darren, slept upstairs with 8-month-old Drake. Darlie says that she was suddenly awakened and saw a man hovering over her with a knife.
And then she saw the back of the guy leaving the house. So she followed him, and when she went out the door, she saw the knife in the utility room. She picked it up to defend herself if he came back in.
Darlie told police that it was only then that she realized that she was injured and that her boys had been attacked.
Darren! Oh, God!
I hear this scream. I run down the stairs.
Oh, my God.
Darlie at that point is yelling, Devin, 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 Devin. I mean, she's just freaking. And I get to Devin, and he's got these 2 huge gashes in the top of his chest. He's laying face up, just blanking his eyes. You know, I'm thinking CPR. I pop his head back. I start blowing into his mouth. And as soon as I blow into his mouth, air comes out of his chest. Blood splatters all over me. Not only have you just been woken up to the worst nightmare in your whole life, your child is dying in front of you. And you just...
Darlie, get some towels!
You don't know what to do.
Investigators did not question Darren's story. But they were troubled by Darlie's statement. They didn't understand how she could have slept through the attack and why she couldn't give a clear description of her assailant.
K
Can you tell me what this person looked like?
No, sir.
When it came time to describe the so-called suspect, she was unable to describe the person, even though the person was supposedly kneeling or sitting, standing on top of her.
Investigators discovered that the screen on an open window had been slashed, but there was an undisturbed layer of dust on the windowsill, suggesting that no one actually came through it. In the cut screen, detectives also found a long, bleached blonde hair. It was the color of Darley's hair at the time. Nothing was missing, so police ruled out robbery. They also found that the blood evidence did not support the story of an intruder.
The lack of a blood trail leading from the crime scene, continuing out the path that the intruder supposedly took, was problematic, to say the least. This individual miraculously manages to keep any sense of blood or any evidence off of him, doesn't leave any footprints. All the blood's contained in one area. That was one of the things that, again, did not jive with her story.
Another puzzling clue was discovered in an alley three houses down from Darley's home. It was a tube sock with small amounts of blood from the two murdered boys.
One of the characteristics of cases where mothers are involved in the killing of children are that after the fact, there's a very amateuristic cover-up. I believe the sock is part of the cover-up. No one wants to believe that a mother would do something like this to their children. But at some point, when you're presented with this type of overwhelming physical evidence, you have to start accepting some of it.
I never suspected that they were looking at Darley. I thought at the hospital they were looking at Darren, but never Darley. And then on the news, there was breaking news, and it showed Darlene in handcuffs, and I started screaming and crying, you know, just unbelievable.
Darley's attorneys and investigators say that the evidence used against her was terribly flawed.
When the officers examined the window which had been cut, they found there was no dust disturbed on the windowsill and also found a blonde hair stuck into the screen area. They assumed that blonde hair was Darley's. Later, that hair, through DNA examination, was determined to belong to a Rowlett police officer. The windowsill is 10 inches off the floor. If you went through the window and crouched down and put one leg through the window, it's more probable you wouldn't disturb the dust than you would disturb the dust.
You're innocent, and you keep waiting for them to come back and tell you that, oh, we've made a terrible mistake, and we're so sorry, and, you know, we found who did this. I just could not believe, you know, what was happening.
Next, Darley's attorneys claim that overlooked fingerprints found at the crime scene prove her innocence. And a juror who voted to convict Darley speaks out in her defense.
I believe with all my heart that Darlene Lutier is innocent. There's not a doubt in my mind.
Darley Lynn Routier, a young Texas housewife, stood accused of viciously killing two of her own children.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to listen very carefully.
According to the DA, Darley Lynn Routier was a greedy, selfish, and vain woman. He said that motherhood was getting in the way of her extravagant lifestyle. The prosecution also suggests that if her two boys were dead, Darley could collect on their life insurance and resume her wild ways. The DA argued that Darley was suffering from postpartum depression and that she slit her own throat and then tried to make it appear that an intruder did it.
And I know it sounds diabolical, but the evidence
they were crucifying her character to make this very conservative jury hate Darley. And it was all a bunch of lies.
It's my opinion that the crime scene was staged.
A medical examiner testified that Darley's wounds were superficial and self-inflicted.
Dramatically different than the wounds sustained by the young victims.
But the defense introduced medical records showing that the knife slash to Darley's neck came within a 1/16 of an inch of severing her carotid artery, which would have killed her. Photographs taken at the hospital show extreme bruising on Darley's arms.
But the notes that you took, that you were telling us about,
Darley's attorneys also attacked the theory that she committed the murders to collect on her boy's life insurance.
They're trying to say she did this for the money. This $5,000 life insurance on those boys, that's ridiculous. It cost $13,000 to bury them.
The prosecution countered with a blood spatter expert. Virtually all of the blood on Darley's shirt was her own. But there was one tiny blood stain on the back that contained both Devin and Damon's blood.
The shirt that Darley was wearing, it had cast off blood on the back over the shoulder area. And this would have come as the knife was being pulled out of the children's body and being brought over her shoulder and then dripping. And the analysis of the DNA indicated it belonged to the children. And that was a very important piece of evidence. How did that blood get there if not that manner?
All the blood evidence was handled by police officers that were not experienced with collecting evidence. And instead of drying that evidence, that bloody evidence out, and putting it the proper way for storing for the trial, they threw it into bags and multiple pieces of blood on top of each other so that the blood stains could transfer from different areas.
We are very careful and methodical in our gathering of evidence. Our officers have been trained in it just like officers across the nation. We haven't just fallen off the hay wagon recently.
Do you recall any statements that
the prosecution also played this videotape for the jury. 8 days after the murders, the Routier family decided to celebrate Devin's 7th birthday posthumously. Darley was on painkillers, antibiotics, and antidepressants. A news crew captured what happened next.
This does not appear to be the behavior of a grieving mother. And all right, fine, let's discount it. She grieves differently than everybody else in the world. But what about all this other preponderance of evidence that's still out there? We can't ignore all the rest of it.
That was a celebration of Devin's birthday. We had invitations sent out. We had presents already bought. And he was murdered 3 days before we got to have his party. We used Silly String because Devin and Damon always played with Silly String. It was one of their favorite things. It's done out of a memory of them. They twisted that and made that into something ugly.
During deliberations, the jury watched the so-called Silly String video 8 times. It took the jury only 10 hours to reach a guilty verdict. Darley Routier was immediately taken to death row at Gatesville State Prison.
Killed the boys.
I'm innocent.
Darley's family and attorneys claim that during the investigation and trial, crucial details were overlooked. They say that the photos of her wounds were not properly presented to the jury. After the trial, one of the jurors who convicted Darley, Charles Sanford, had a chance to take a close look at the pictures.
After I saw the pictures, it made me feel that she's not guilty. She did not cut herself, and that she put up a heck of a fight to protect her own self. I believe with all my heart that Darley Routier is innocent. There's not a doubt in my mind.
Darley's defenders also point to the mysterious tube sock that was found 75 yards from the crime scene.
The sock contains both boys' blood and probably epithelial or skin DNA of Darley. There are no blood stains that belong to Darley on the sock. So it obviously had to be touched by someone after both boys had been stabbed who also had contact with Darley.
Darley's supporters say that examining the timeline that night makes the prosecution's account of the murders impossible. Medical testimony established that Damon could not have lived for more than 9 minutes after receiving his fatal wound, and that he did not die until the paramedics arrived. So before they arrived, the following events must have happened. Darley talked to a 911 operator for 5 minutes and 40 seconds of those 9 minutes. The police secure the crime scene for an additional 2 of those 9 minutes before paramedics were let in. That leaves Darlie Routier approximately a minute and a half to place the sock 75 yards down the street, stage a crime scene, and then cut her own throat.
I believe that the intruder had the sock on his hand, probably used as a glove or something, and I believe that he was covering her mouth. I don't believe she did sleep through it. I believe that she was asphyxiated. She was completely unconscious, and during the time of her becoming conscious is when she says, "I woke up."
Darlie's family believes unidentified fingerprints at the crime scene belong to the intruder. A fingerprint on the door leading to the garage and a second print on the credenza behind the couch have never positively been identified by investigators.
They're not Darlie's, they're not Darren's, and they're not either of the two boys. I think it shows the overall problems with the case, that the state did not investigate the case fully, that they focused on Darlie from not day one, but minute one.
An intruder did come into my house, that man does exist, and he's walking free while my wife is on death row for something she didn't do.
Darlie's family believes the attacker may have been a sexual predator. A series of violent rapes occurred in the Dallas area at the same time as the Routier murders. These crimes were quite similar to the attack on Darlie and her children. The assailant enters the unlocked homes of victims, attacks them with knives found in the kitchen, and wears tube socks over his hands to avoid leaving fingerprints. Could this person have been the real killer? Darlie's lawyers continue to appeal her sentence. If and when those appeals are exhausted, she'll be executed. If you have any information about this case, please log on to our website at unsolved.com.